a tech recruiter calls out of nowhere and they say, hey, do you want to interview at this big famous software company? And you go, yeah, that's kind of cool. And they would ask you this crazy question. They would say, okay, so imagine you're at a browser and you type in www.redhat.com and you hit enter. What happens? And you're now left to kind of try to answer this really tough open-ended question, not really ever knowing whether you're answering it right. And so we're going to explain what actually happens.
Okay. So
as soon as you hit that enter button and you begin your journey to developers.redhat.com, there's a lot that's going to happen.
The browser has to make a DNS request to figure
out. Oh, not so fast. First, you have to establish your actual network connection to that DNS server.
Oh man. Yeah.
When you first establish your connection with your ISP or your router, you would have likely established a resolver IP address. That's going to initiate your entrance into the internet.
So once you're connected to the internet, what happens? The first thing that happens before you can ever start to get assets from the server and start to build the web page in your browser is you have to use DNS.
DNS stands for Domain Name System, and it is basically a registry of names and IP addresses or numbers.
I mean, it's really like one of the main things of how the internet works.
You'd think about it how now we have our phone, right? And you have a name, say mom, and you just say call mom, right? And it knows that mom is associated with this number. That's DNS in a nutshell.
So you'd think once you have the DNS name, you can just go right to the server, but actually you go to a CDN.
Why do we need a content delivery network or a CDN? And the answer is for three reasons, and that's scalability, performance, and security.
They're co-located all over the world in many different points of presence.
You get like thousands of people coming to your site in a short period of time. All of that traffic will be offloaded onto the CDN.
One site goes down, you've got another one to back things up.
So it doesn't bring down your origin servers.
One of the things that the CDN gives us, a lot of other computers that are actually surfacing our site. So for example, someone in America and someone in Asia and someone in Europe will all get the same website, but they're actually served from different physical boxes from the CDN.
So you'd think the CDN would just go back to the origin server every time, but it doesn't do that. Because if it did, it would slow the entire website down. What it actually does is it caches those files locally, which then makes it faster for the end user to get it in that geography.
Anytime that you encounter something that has been cached, you're saving yourself a lot of trouble. You don't have to do a lot of processing to build up those connections and break them back down. The content's right there.
Another benefit of caching is site failovers and outages in your origin. If you have something that's cached on the edge and that copy is still on the edge, if the origin is down, and it can still continue to serve it.
And that's governed by something called a TTL.
Time to life?
Time to live.
We always call it TTL.
The time to live determines how long that caching server will keep that content. So if the TTL is set to 60 minutes or 60 seconds or 60 days, it will hold that content for that amount of time. So you might think there's a single origin server and it serves the entire CDN, but that might not be the case. In a very large website, you'll often need multiple origin servers, and they're often front-ended with something called a load balancer.
What the load balancer does is it distributes traffic across multiple servers. It's a way of spreading out the amount of requests.
So it's not all running off of one server.
So if you get 1 or 100 or 1,000 CDN servers all talking to your origin server at the same time, you can handle it. So the origin server has to get its content from somewhere. It goes to a CMS, the content management system.
Drupal is our content management system, or our CMS. Basically, it is a repository of all the different web pages that are served up on developers.redhat.com, but mostly things like text and images are served from Drupal. And that's just a repository where the editors and the authors for the content can go and they can do any kind of tagging.
So a lot of times when you go and look at a piece of content, it will be tagged with a subject or a label. And that label helps determine what things you're interested in and helps recommend other things that you'd probably like to read.
So once the request has been sent, there's all sorts of things that go on in the back. There's ways of treating the content and the assets that are sent back. You can tweak, I guess. Is that a technical term?
Yeah, there's another technical term, tune.
Oh, okay. It's a whole nother world beyond the back-end services and things that you may be, if you're coming from a back-end perspective, the front end seems like a really simple thing, but it actually can go very, very deep.
But there's a lot more happening in the front end before the page completely renders and a user can actually interact with the web page.
As soon as we've actually got a response back from the server, which will include any HTTP headers and then also the actual HTML for the web page, the browser will take it and it'll do as sequentially as possible. It'll go through and actually parse the HTML. It'll go and look for and flag things like images, JavaScript, CSS, additional resources that it will need to go fetch to actually show you the completed website. And it'll go do all of that as quickly as it can.
There's two sets of speeds. There's how fast is the asset loaded in time, in physics.
Ideally, 100 or so milliseconds.
200 milliseconds is actually the magical number.
Right.
I'm not going to say that all of our pages load that fast. Some of them do not, especially if you're downloading RHEL.
On the other side, though, it's how fast is it perceived.
You have literal milliseconds to display the page before a user may lose interest.
People strive to get that instant response, instant page load, and it's very hard to do it and do it right.
So when a page loads really quickly, it feels like black magic, but there's actually a lot of art that goes into it.
There's definitely something to be said about tricks of the trade, little sleight of hand kinds of things that you do to make your website look like it's faster than it might actually be.
How to handle those assets, how to present the content in a way that displays properly across devices.
Make sure you compress everything that's compressible.
Assets like style sheets and JavaScript, obviously the big thing for them is to minify those so that they're as small a package as possible so that the browser doesn't need to wait for them to download. It can start parsing them immediately.
There's a lot of skill in how that page is rendered.
And it's something that changes as technology changes.
Once developers.redhat.com is fully rendered, a developer gets to participate in the community that we've created and also participate in the content that we've created. Things like videos, blogs, cheat sheets, and courses to learn things like OpenShift, RHEL, and Knative in a way that's best suited to their learning experience.
When you ask this question, you're going to get a lot of different answers. And there's nothing wrong with that. Everybody has their own expertise. So how would you answer what happens when you hit enter?